want me to put the baby up now or what?
Baby goes up tonight.
Okay.
I read the coolest post on Facebook. I laughed so hard I about peed my pants.
Yeah.
It said, if you are out doing last minute Christmas shopping, please be nice to retail workers. It's not their fault you waited until Mary's water broke to do your shopping.
Oh my gosh, that's funny.
I laughed so hard.
Yeah, I know. Would people actually get mad at people? Like,
they do. It's crazy.
I don't know.
It's
people,
crazy.
People are crazy.
People are crazy.
I'm just like, what? Why? Like, you waited. Whose fault is it?
Exactly.
You know?
That's exactly what I said.
I don't have time for that.
That's like on Black Friday, like my little sister and I run through the store singing Christmas carols and our
I was going to say, it's crazy out here. What do you expect? I know. Because, I mean, I see these ladies and they're out there, like, earrings in, flashing all over the place, wearing not enough clothes.
Right.
All that kind of stuff. And you're like, all right, well, welcome to the crazy.
Here, I'll just write it. Ruth is crazy. But the pen won't work. Let's try another one. There we go. Ruth is crazy. I wrote it at the very end.
Father, we thank you that today we celebrate the coming of our Savior. We're thankful for him and thankful that you've gathered us together. Thank you for our families. Thank you for love that has come down from heaven to us so that we know how to love one another. And we pray that you please bless our service today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, and I welcome you in to our beautiful sanctuary. Welcome in on Facebook, too. We're glad you're here. If you didn't already, when you came in, you can put your offering in the table on the table in the back, and there's offering envelopes, and if you didn't get one and you want them, just see Miss Shelley, and she'll print them out for you. Would you bow in prayer with me? Father, we come here this morning waiting for your birth. Please be with us during this service, and may it be a blessing to you. Amen.
Before I do the Advent reading this morning, we do have a tradition here at Willow Creek when we get new members, they get an ornament for the tree. And we have been blessed this year. You don't get to keep your ornaments, though. I'm going to be an Indian giver today because they have not been engraved yet. They will be engraved with your names before they're hung on the tree. But I did want to make sure you got them before Christmas, at least knew that we loved you and we thought about you. So, Trevor Jackson, could you come up? You joined this year. Tommy and Elena Saylor. Miss Carolyn Chamberlain. And I have two that joined that are not here today, but I have Georgia Gill Elkins who joined and Sherry Watring, who was not only joined but was also baptized. So these are our new members, and we welcome you to the Willow Creek family. Those will get engraved, and then once they're engraved, they'll go on the tree next year with everybody else's, okay? All right. So I will take them back from you. Sorry. Thank you very much. I'm honored to read the fourth Sunday of Advent season, and I'm honored to have my mother-in-law with me to light the candles. This is our fourth Sunday of Advent, and tonight we'll celebrate Jesus' birth together. Jesus is our greatest treasure, yet what can this Savior give to us that the world doesn't already have? The world can give us bits and pieces of hope, joy, and peace. But Jesus gives us complete hope, complete joy, and complete peace. Because he can forgive our sins. The Bible tells us our sins have separated us from God. Every person is a sinner, and nothing in this world can take our sins away. Jesus came down from heaven to earth to take the punishment for our sins upon himself. Jesus did this so that whoever believes in him will be saved. In Isaiah 53:2-6, we read about Jesus 400 years before he came to earth. Isaiah writes, "For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our grief and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds, we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all."
Good morning. Would you stand and sing with me this morning?
To babe on bended knee, the Savior of humanity. Unto us a child is born, he shall reign forevermore. No. God has done. Noel, Noel, the story of amazing love, the light of the world given for us. God and Son of Man, there before the world began, born to suffer, born to save, born to raise us from the grave. Christ the everlasting Lord, he shall reign forevermore. Noel, Noel, come and see what God has done. Story of amazing love, the light of the world given for us. Noel. Come and see what God has done. Noel, Noel, the story of amazing love, the light of the world given for us.
The next song is What Child Is This?
What child is this who laid to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems? come sweet, while shepherds watch our keeping. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste to bring him loud, the babe, the Son of Mary. So bring him incense, gold, and myrrh, come peasant king to own him. King of kings, salvation brings, let loving hearts enthrone him. Raise a song on high, the virgin sings her lullaby. Joy for Christ is born, the babe, the Son of Mary. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste to bring him love, the babe, the Son of Mary. Nail's spear shall pierce him through, the cross he bore for me, for you. Hail the world made flesh, the babe, the Son of Mary.
Would you greet your neighbor? Hi, everybody on Facebook. Merry Christmas.
All right, good morning. We are so glad to have you here this morning. Those that are on Facebook that are watching us, we greet you as well. We're glad that you've decided to spend your Christmas with us, and together as a family, we've come here to worship Jesus. This is the time of our service, though, that we have the opportunity to be able to share maybe some of the joys that we have that's going on in our life. Maybe just sharing about our lives or any concerns which we have, and so I got to open it up. So does anybody want to share about maybe what the Lord is doing in their life or just concerns they may have or just anything else that they want to share this morning? Would anybody like to get us started? Yes, Donna. Amen. Praise the Lord in that. So miss that guy. So if he's watching, we miss you, Richard. Anybody else? Yes, Ruth.
You know, I'm going to speak for all the wives out there. We take our husbands for granted. Mine's been sick and under the weather for the last couple of days, and I really, really, really realize how much I depend on him to help me with things. So I just ask for prayers for Roy. He is down with COVID right now and staying away from me and everybody else in the world. And I just ask that you be with him.
Yes, Amelia, what do you have for us?
My grandma is gone, and my family is here.
Yeah, she's grateful that her grandma and grandpa are here. So, there's the wave of the hand. If you want to meet my mother and father afterwards, you'll be happy to do so. So, yes, Wayne?
My youngest son, Tom, and his family have come down with flares.
Okay. Sorry to hear that. Certainly be in prayer for them. Anybody else? Anything that they would like to share? Well, I'll just say at the bottom of my heart, I'm just really grateful to be here this Christmas. To be a pastor, it is a great joy. I don't know, the last few months and things to get to know you all, and I look forward to getting you to know you even more and more. And it's been sweet. It really has been a tremendous joy of mine. And I just look forward to what the Lord's going to do in this next year, and we're going to be praying for that as well. So, if there's nothing else, let's join together in a word of prayer, and we ask for God's blessings. Father, we come to you, and we come to you with our hearts, and we thank you that you take a great interest in us, that if we love you with our hearts, Father, that you call us your children, and as your children, that you take care of us as a good heavenly Father, and you meet us exactly where we are. I thank you that in sickness, you bring comfort. In healing, we know that your hand is surely there. Father, during this Christmas, I pray that we know that we are blessed because you have given us the greatest gift that any person could receive, and that is the coming into the knowing of your Son, Jesus. He is everything our hearts long for. He is everything in which we want. Coming to know him is the sweetest thing that we can ever experience in this life, and I thank you that the joy that you give us through him is actually greater than anything in this world because it's a joy we get to be able to have for eternity. So I pray that we come and we think about this king this morning, this king who came very humbly. He came to us being wrapped in swaddling clothes, laying in a manger, most humble of means. He came down from the heavenly places for us so that through him that we may be brought home. And so that we can be with you forever. We pray that you would please bless the remainder of our service. And I pray that you would touch our hearts. We pray that your spirit would work mightily in us. Pray that you would change us, direct us, encourage us. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Would you stand for the doxology?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Our scripture this morning comes from Luke chapter 2, verses 8 through 20. In the same region, the shepherds were staying out in the fields and keeping watch at night over their flock. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And then they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for look, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all people. Today in the city of David, a Savior was born to you, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find the baby wrapped tightly in cloth and lying in a manger." Suddenly there was a multitude of the heavenly host with an angel praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth to people he favors." When the angels had left them and returned to heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go straight to Bethlehem and see what has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." They hurried off and found both Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in a manger. After seeing them, they reported the message that they were told about the child, and all who heard were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary was treasuring all these up things in her heart and meditating on them. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had seen and heard, just as they had been told. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Before we get into our message this morning, there's a few other things that I want to go over just real quickly before we get into things. And first is, for this evening's candlelight service, I'm still looking for two readers for that. So if you have an interest in that, please let me know. I can sign people up. There are little small people that I have in my family that I coerce into doing things when I don't have enough volunteers. But I can get them to do it, but I would like to ask for volunteers in that. And also to announce that, of course, this evening we do have a candlelight service. You're invited to come back here this evening at 7 o'clock, and I promise that it will be mercifully short. I know that you're busy. I understand that you may be running around trying to see family,
maybe going from party to party and seeing people to people, but we're just making a small period of time for you to come and just really put Jesus first during this Christmas season. And so it's a time just to be solemn, to focus on him, and to put him first in your life. And I know that he will greatly love that you made him first in your life. Today's message I've entitled, Good News of Great Joy. Good News of Great Joy. Angels, as you often know, are of great interest to many of us. We think about them, that we wonder about them and what they are like. But this is especially true this time of year, because whether we recognize it or not, we really can't have Christmas unless we have angels as well. They're just a big part of the story, and it doesn't seem where you go that angels seem to be missing. We see angels in our nativity scenes, whether that's on ourselves or out in our yards. We might be able to see angels that are just posted all by themselves in places, of course, overlooking this very holy child. We see angels on ornaments, and as I was even sitting down, I said, hey, look, there's an angel. It's on the top of our tree. And so even though that when we think of Christmas, we're thinking about Jesus, we're thinking about maybe family, and maybe angels aren't on the forefront of our minds, in truth, it really isn't Christmas unless we really have these holy ones. The word angel actually comes from a translated Greek word of angelos, which simply means messenger. It means if this is a message that is sent by God and this individual has been entrusted with this message in order to give to somebody else. Sometimes these messages are admittedly very good messages. Some, as you imagine, aren't very good messages. And sometimes they are very difficult ones. But given that their actual name means messenger, we can actually tell a lot about an angel just simply by the activity in which they're doing. And judging by this passage, with the thousands and thousands of angels that come, this is actually telling us that this is the most important message that God could possibly even give to us. Just to make sure that we're all in the same place, before of what we read this morning, we actually read about Jesus' birth. We see at the beginning of Luke chapter 2 about how Mary, and a very pregnant Mary at that, and Joseph travel, and they're going to the hometown of Bethlehem to be counted in a royal census by Caesar Augustus. We see that they're there, and the time for this child is coming comes. And so there it is, at a very unexpected place and a very unexpected means that we read about this child. She gives birth, and most likely in a stable, because this child is wrapped in swaddling clothes and laid in a manger in which was a feeding trough for animals. And so it's the assumption that there must have been animals around. And even though this is unusual, and even though that this may have been very difficult for this couple, it was probably the most wonderful moment in their marriage so far. Even though it's so unusual, this is good news of the greatest of joys. But what we read about is there shortly thereafter, that God, like a good father, begins to want to tell everybody about this coming son. He can't keep it into himself. He has the desire in order to share. And so that what we see in this scene is how after Jesus is born, that God sends a divine message that is unlike anything that anybody has ever heard before or even since. It is something that is extraordinary news, and it's something that comes to the ordinary shepherd. Shepherds were doing what you had probably expected they're doing. They're taking care of sheep. And we know that it was by night. So maybe that they're sitting down, and maybe they're getting ready for dinner, or maybe that they're laying down to go to sleep at night. And so they were there, and they were just going through the normal routines of life. And then here it is that they're startled by coming of yet another angel. Now, why do I say yet another angel? Is because this is one of the many messengers that God has already sent. You need to pull back for a moment and think about this, that God has been silent for these last 400 years in Israel's history. All the way from the book of Isaiah and until now to the intertestament period between the Old and New Testament, there's been silence, there's been stillness. God hasn't said anything at all. Perhaps the people are beginning to think that their God had abandoned them, but certainly he didn't. But now, here, even as Luke begins, as we read in Matthew, there's a multitude of angels that come. The first angel that we read about comes to a man named Zechariah, who's a priest in the temple. And this angel tells him about how he's going to have a child who's the forerunner of Jesus. We see a little bit later that that same angel appears to Mary and says to her that she's going to bear the Son of the Most High God, and that she has this divine responsibility because she has found favor with God. We see in this passage about how it is that the shepherds have come, and even shortly before that, that Joseph sees in a dream another angel that commands him to take Mary home as his wife, and of course the shepherds. But even after this story, if you just keep reading in the Gospel of Luke, you actually read that there's a man named Simeon, and that there's a prophetess named Anna, all who've been told by God that this child is going to come. And what makes this moment so special, so unique of all of them, of every declaration that is made, is it comes with the very presence of God that is shown to them. We read in this passage that as the angel comes and he startles these shepherds, he comes with the presence of God. It says so in verse 9. It tells us the glory of the Lord shone about them. The invisible God, who is spirit, does not have a body like man, who cannot be seen by the human eye, chooses to manifest himself as light, as pure light, showing that this is the holiest of all messages. And so you have to wonder, and I know it's easy to jump forward in the narrative, but sometimes we got to act as we never read this before. But what is this angel going to say to them? First, it's really a words of comfort, but then they also give us another affirmation of eternal comfort. The angel first says to them in verse 10, he says, "Fear not, for I bring you good news of tremendous joy." So he says, don't fear about what I'm going to say. You don't have to hide yourself. You don't have to put on kind of your best of duds. You don't have to wash behind your ears. You don't have to put on a face. I am coming to bring you a kind of one-way kind of message to you. And it's described literally as news of extreme joy. If you actually look at this in the Greek, it's the word for news. That's what it says. It's good news. But joy is the only one that has a modifier that's given to it. It's actually given the word, and you can kind of geek out on it just a little bit, is it has the word megas attributed to it. It should sound to you like the word mega, because that's exactly what it is. It says, this is a megas kind of charis. This is a great kind of joy. And in fact, if you actually look up the word for this megas, it can be translated as great or the greatest. This is big, this is exceedingly large. It has the meaning of this wide application. So this isn't just a joy that is just for the here and now or just in the moment. This is a joy that is all-encompassing to everything, for every facet of your life. what they're saying, that this is big and this is deep and this is wonderful. And so here it is that I think Luke and the wisdom of God makes it so that the focus is, I'm bringing you something that is going to completely blow your mind. It is so tremendous and it is great. And my kids will actually tell you that this is actually one of my favorite passages in all the Bible, because I like to focus on words. You know, that's what I like to do. I like to look at sentence structures and I look to see how it's made up, because I really do believe that there's so much good in just looking at these fine details. But to see that they're saying this is an encompassing kind of joy that is unequaled to anything else. How many of us have experienced anything like that? How many of us have experienced incredible joy, life-filling kinds of joy? I know that I have. I mean, I'm sure that you have too. That you think back through your life about some of the most joy-filled things that you ever experienced. I can say for myself that those joys came when I got married. It came with the coming of every one of my kids. I didn't want anybody to know that I didn't have a new child. I was very happy about every single one of them. Even the calling as pastor to a church. It's always this thing of tremendous joy. And dare I say it, one of the other great joys of my life is just simply making friends. It's a joy. It's something that makes it so that I almost had this hum of life inside of myself. And so with these words, you have this angel that is saying, I have this great, the good news of the tremendous kind of joy. And you have to wonder, what's he going to say? We know what he's going to say, but what are they thinking inside their soul? Is it a gift? Is it a treasure? In some ways it is. But it goes on to say, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. What you've been given is a Savior, a forever king, a good king, a king that's going to make everything else in your life that's different. And so this child, who will this child be? Well, we're already told by this, by the angel. Who is this child for? Is it just for the Israelites, or is it just for some very special kinds of people? No, the angel has already said in verse 10 that this is a message that will be for every single person. There's not a person who does not benefit from this king. That is for all the people, whether it's you or you or you or you, there's no discrimination. It's for every single person. In fact, every person has a need of this Jesus. Every person has a need of this tremendous, penetrating kind of joy that only that he can provide. And this actually kind of leads into maybe kind of a side note is that this actually shows us that every person has a need for Jesus. And I think deep down inside, they know it. They know it. It may come as a surprise, but the Bible actually teaches us there's no such thing as an atheist. There isn't. A person may believe that in principle, may say they don't believe in God, you don't believe in this Jesus, but deep down inside, they do know that there is one. And how do we know that? Because God has actually told us that they do. In Romans chapter 1, it actually tells us that through creation itself, that we can see by meticulous detail, by the cosmos, the things that are around us, the wonder of everything that is around us, that there is a creator. There is a God, and no one is without excuse for not knowing this God. It tells us there in Romans chapter 1, verse 20, for God's invisible attributes, namely his internal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, And he goes on to say, ever since the creation of the world and the things in which have been made, so that every single person is without excuse. And so that's big long if you've not read through that before. But what he's saying is all these divine attributes in which God has of his goodness, of his detail, of his care, of his power, whatever it is, it's in creation. It's there in a cradle. It's there in love. It's there in beauty. It's there in everywhere. His fingerprints are over everything. And for someone to claim that they don't believe a God actually is not true, because deep down inside, they actually do, because God says they do. And this, even for a person who rejects Jesus, rejects God, Jesus has come for people even like them. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that grace-filled? And I like how this angel kind of goes. We get this scene of the angels that come and they begin to sing. They give this most beautiful song. If there's a few moments in history that I could see other than Jesus, I'd probably want to see this. There's thousands of angels filling the night sky, singing of this glorious one, the one that stepped down. And what the angel of the Lord actually invites them to do is, well, if you don't believe me, go and find yourself. You can go see this child. You know, if you don't believe me, you don't take my word for it. It's like you can go into Bethlehem, you can find this child, you can see him for what he really is, and you can see if he really is this Savior, if he really is this King that I've been telling you of, the two most tremendous kinds of joy, you can experience him yourself. And so after the song is sung, they began to ask him, and I always think it's the funniest thing. He said, let's go see that thing that they talked about. Let's go see the stuff, right? Let's go see that thing that the angels are talking about here. It's like, let's go. And so they actually run to find this child. And for whatever reason, it is a sign, because it's wrapped in swaddling clothes, it's laying in a manger, and that they actually go to see this Jesus and experience him for themselves. And if we have any indicator for what happens in that very intimate a place, they actually leave there glorifying and praising God for exactly what they've seen. I don't know what happened when they went in there. I don't know if they just knocked on the door and said, hey, is there a Savior here? Maybe they just squeaked the door open. Maybe there was a gate, you know. Maybe there was animals. I don't really know what happened there. I don't even know what the conversation. We do know that Mary treasured all these things in her heart. We do know that there's at least some detail, but what transpired there and what they saw and what they experienced, we don't really know. But we do know the outcome is when they looked into the face of this child, they began to find a joy they had never experienced before. It was a completing kind of joy. It was where life made sense kind of joy. And I was thinking about it this week, and thinking about it is, how can looking at a child do that? I mean, I'm kind of a logical person. I'm just sitting there going, like, you just looked at a baby, right? Like, I know how babies are. They go through like 12 to 16 diapers per day. At the very beginning, I mean, sheesh, I know about babies. You know, that's a pretty messy scene that's going on there and transpires. So she, like, you think about it, it's like, this looks like any other baby. This looks like any other child, right? I mean, what makes this child so different from everything else? And I think that I had struggles in trying to understand how to explain it, but I finally landed at one, and you'll have to forgive me if I've reused this too many times before. But what I immediately thought of is how to describe how that they looked at this child was like when Peter, Edmund, and Susan and Lucy go to Narnia and they enter it and they meet the son of the emperor who is over the sea. Aslan, the great lion, is the king, the high king over all of Narnia. He is the King who is over everything. When the children look into Aslan's eyes, C.S. Lewis says several times that the children feel strangely warmed. They look at him in his eyes and know that they are understood. Their hearts begin to fill to the utmost. They feel at times as if their hearts could simply burst. They find that the longer that they stroke his hair and the fur on his back, and the closer that they come to him, the more confidence it builds in them, and the more rest that comes to their souls. In fact, in the first book, when the children stay the longest, the longer they stay with him, the greater their joy becomes, the greater their laughter, the greater their ease, and all their friendships become what they're always meant to be. Just looking into his eyes means that you're looking into Jesus' eyes is looking into the eyes of God. And somehow, in some way, we just know it's him. We just know, like, there's a peace. And I don't know how to explain it. I don't know how to put it in words. It doesn't make sense. Like, why I should look at anything and think to myself that this is great and wonderful. But they saw this child, and they, too, were strangely warmed. I don't think they could put it into words. They knew that they were understood. They know they looked into a very unique child. Nobody has ever been before and ever after would be like this, because this is God who has come down. And who has he come down for? For them. It's come down for you. It's come down for me. It's for all the people. And what does he bring with him? The good news of the greatest of joy, a joy that fills us from the inside out. Probably don't know this about me, but this passage like this is the exact reason that I became a pastor. I didn't become a pastor just so I could, I don't know, knock somebody up the side of the head with a Bible or do other things. It was really simply this. I came to know Jesus, and he brought me forever joy. He brought me happiness, blessedness, peace, which goes on beyond any way to begin to explain. I can't tell you why looking at Jesus filled my life, except for that it did. And so he still does. And as a person, I simply wanted every single person to know this Jesus like I did, because he was my greatest joy, and I wanted them to be joy-filled too. I know a lot of this sounds perhaps fishy, strange. Both of us have lived in the world where if it looks too good to be true, then it must simply be, right? But I assure you, this is not too good to be true, because it comes directly from the heart of God. What I like about this Jesus is that he invites us to come and experience him. It's a come and see kind of God. He says, come to me, all who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That come to the Lord and taste and see that he is good. Here's all these invitations in Scripture saying, don't take my word for it. Don't take another person's word for it. God actually says, come to me and find out for yourself if I am this joy-filling kind of Savior who takes away the sins of the world. That's what he does. And the truth is that whether we know it or not, Jesus did walk on this earth. This is not some sort of make-believe story. There is a historical Jesus. There is a man who came and walked and he lived and he died. there is a man, even the best of historians will say, there was a Jesus, there was a man who was in Jerusalem, and that he was claimed to be all these things. The only problem is that many historians just don't agree about who he was. There is a historical Jesus. And I'm telling you, as someone who's experienced him for myself, he was the best news of the greatest of joys. And so I believe that if you don't know this Jesus today, he invites you in to come to know him, to come and experience and just see that he is so good. Come and see for yourself. Don't take my word for it, somebody else's word for it. Come and see for yourself. And he is the one, when we look into the eyes of God, we're strangely warmed, we're brought to peace, because we know we were made for him. I would say that as we close in our message today, I'd like to pray a simple prayer with you to invite Jesus into your life. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you sent Jesus into the world to seek that which was lost. Father, maybe we're lost. Maybe we don't even realize how lost that we are. Everybody is on the pathway to God. The problem is, many of us are running away from you instead of to you. I don't know what it is that we are fearful of, maybe to be lorded over, perhaps that we are afraid to be rejected like everybody else. But you have promised that those that come by faith in Jesus will never be turned away. And so, Father, I pray that we would do the same thing. We would come and say, Lord, I cast off all these burdens. Lord, I don't want anything more to do with these sins. I want Jesus. I want my life to be at peace. I want it to be full. And I know that's only something that you can bring. So please forgive me for the wrongs in which we have done. Pray that you'd have mercy upon us. I pray that you would come in and make yourself home with me and I with you. Pray again that you do so quickly. And thank you, Father, for hearing a prayer just like this. We pray and ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Today we have the great joy that we want to share together in Holy Communion. This is a practice that Christians have been doing for centuries, for millennia. It is one of the most beautiful of all practices, and I don't know what you know about communion, but it goes back to the time when Jesus was sitting with his disciples, sitting in that Last Supper, and they were with him. They got to see him and behold him, and he shared this last meal with them. He did it so that they would be reminded of his sacrificial work at the cross. He would symbolize in the bread that this was his body that was given for them. He would symbolize in the cup that this was the cup that was given for them, and it was his blood done for the remission of sins. And he told them to never forget about this. This is a life-changing moment, and we as Christians share together in that same kind of moment. What we're going to do is when we take Holy Communion, I invite you that if you're a believer in Jesus, that you take these things along with us. That you would be reminded that even though that this is just a cup and it just has bread and we just have juice, this should be a reminder that this is Jesus given for me. It's for me. Yes, it's given for people in this room too, but individualistically. I know that we can sometimes be too individualistic in the things which we do, but yes, it's a Jesus that loved me and he gave himself for me. And so that as we go to those things, Lord, I guess I would just pray for us that we would look at it as Lord's giving of himself to us. in this cup. But we also do this together. We don't do this in our homes. We don't do this just all by ourselves. We do it in the community of believers. Not because we couldn't, it's just that we do it with other brothers and sisters in Christ who need his grace just as much as we do. And it is a way for us to grow together. So I would invite those that are administering the Lord's Supper today to please come forward. And as they do, I'd like to have a short prayer, and then we'll get into the Lord's Supper. Father, as we come together, I pray that we are reminded of the grace that we have in Jesus. And this cup is just bread, it's just juice. It's true, but you told us to do this in remembrance of you. That when we take of these things, this is the body which has been given for us. This is the blood that has been shed for us. You laid down your life in order to save us. You did because you loved us. And so you laid everything down. I pray that we would be blessed during this. And I pray that when we get these things, that we would hold on to these cups and that we would do this together as a church and that we celebrate you. And we just pray that you'd please bless this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand and come forward to receive the bread and the cup. read from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 26. Now as they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, he gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Take and eat together." Likewise, he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you, for this is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." Let's take and drink together.
Would you stand with me and sing our closing song, "O Come, All You Faithful"?
O come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant, O come, ye, O come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. God of God, light of light, lo, he abhors not the virgin's womb. True God, begotten, not created. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Sing, choirs of angels, sing in exaltation. Sing, all ye citizens of heaven above. Glory to God, glory in the highest. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Yea, Lord, we greet thee, born this happy morning. Jesus, to thee be all glory give. Word of the Father, now in flesh appearing, O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him, Christ. the Lord. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord.
May be seated. We have one last announcement before we're dismissed.
It's an announcement, it's a celebration, it's a recognition, if you will. Shelley and Dean and Robbie, could the three of you please come down to the front? You know, service doesn't just happen. A lot of people think that it just happens. It would happen without them as long as God was here, but it happens a whole lot better with these people, okay? We are blessed as a church. We have been very blessed people-wise, giving-wise, financially-wise. And so this year, we as a board voted to give out bonuses. And they're not huge, but they are a token of our love and our respect and our thanks for everything that you guys give up every Sunday morning to make our worship service that much better and brighter.
Merry Christmas, Shelley. Merry Christmas, Shelley. You can't tell which one's my favorite.
I'd also like to recognize Tommy Saylor, who, starting in July, when we transitioned from being a Methodist conference church to being an independent Willow Creek church, stepped up and said, "I'll do music." I'm like, "Thank you, Jesus, because nobody wants to listen to me." So, Tommy, you've done a fantastic job, and we just want to say thank you and Merry Christmas. And I saved the best for last. When we started this process in July of being an independent church and searching for a pastor, I prayed a lot. I was stressed a lot. Being the head trustee and trying to make sure that everything transitioned, not just smoothly, but legally, to try to make sure that all of our I's were dotted and all of our T's were crossed. And then to try to make sure that we found the right fit for our congregation, that we found that person that loved God as much as we love God, that person that would bring God to life for not just us, but for this community. And I feel like we did that. The board spent a lot of time. We listened to a lot of pastors. We interviewed a lot of candidates before we listened to pastors. It was a laborious process. There's my word for the day, laborious. It was a laborious process. But good things come to those who wait. Just like Jesus came for us, good things come to those who wait. So, Pastor Steve Stutzman, we are blessed and we are honored to offer you this bonus this year, and we pray that we get the opportunity to do so for many years to come.
Amen. Thank you. All I know is that whole time when she was buttering up, I was like, I hope that's me. Right, so it's like, I hope that's me, you know, it is me, so it really is a great pleasure to be here, and again, I do look forward to our time to come, and I'm praying for a lot more Christmases, you know, we can say that together, at least I'm saying amen, so I think that's a great thing. Let's have our closing benediction. trying to think now just how to send you out. I guess I can just pray, and I guess a verse that comes to mind is Galatians 2:20. And these are just our last words. I just felt like I just needed to say them. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. May you go in his peace. All right, amen. You're dismissed.
Seventy.
That's pretty good. Yeah, it's scary up there as far as I'm concerned.